Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate on the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill at Stage 1. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is consideration of Motion 13176 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill. And I call Shirley-Ann Somerville to move the motion. Cabinet Secretary.
Apologies, Presiding Officer, I forgot about this bit. Formally moved.
So did I, almost. And the question is, this question will be, on this motion, will be put at decision time. And so, to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 13466, in the name of Neil Gray, on a vision for health and social care in Scotland. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Neil Gray to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, around 12 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. We have reached a critical point in our country's health. We are seeing growing demand upon our health and social care services that needs addressed, alongside an improvement in service performance. The growing demand based on our poor population health both reduces the well-being of Scotland and impacts the sustainability of our services. This Government is clear that the NHS in Scotland and the values that underpin its work is an institution of national pride, and I also recognise the vital role of the social care system in supporting people to manage their health within their communities, to live well. The principles of a health service for everyone, owned by the people and free at the point of delivery, are sacrosanct. Let me be clear that any consideration of abandoning those fundamental values lies beyond a red line that we will not cross. However, while those principles will not change, Scotland itself has changed. The NHS was established 76 years ago to address the health challenges of its time. Now we live longer, medicines can do much more, technology has transformed the way we live, and our lifestyles have changed. And the treatment of people in hospitals when they are ill is only a small part of modern healthcare. And while this government is making progress in addressing the challenges of waiting lists, our health and social care services are hard-pressed to meet service demand. So today I will seek to open a debate of openness and in good faith on how we can reform and improve our health services and how we can collectively deliver a transformed system fit for the health challenges we face. Presiding Officer, I am a pragmatist. We have a clear vision for the direction of reform, which we'll shortly outline, and a programme of improvements, which is already underway. I give way briefly to Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention on that point. And one way that the health service can be prevented from being overburdened is to introduce the audit of fracture liaison services, which the government committed to in April 2023. Can the government now confirm, does it still intend to carry out and publish that audit? And if so, when will it start?
Cabinet Secretary.
So in terms of the details of the service delivery that we can achieve, there's areas such as that that I think we should be developing upon, which is why I'm looking for this debate to be held today, so that we can take forward the ideas that we think can help on the prevention agenda, can improve our population health and improve our public health measures. I'm willing to also consider fresh ideas. I'm here today asking this chamber to consider how, together, we can seize the opportunity to reform health and social care for present and future generations. I've already outlined to my Cabinet colleagues an overarching vision which will guide our work. This vision is one which no one here could argue, I believe, a Scotland where people live longer, healthy and fulfilling lives. This vision is supported by four key areas of work: improving population health, a focus on prevention and early intervention, providing quality services and maximising access, with all of these underpinned by giving due consideration to the people at the heart of those services. In the short term, we must ensure that our services are delivered in the best way we can within our current arrangements, and in the medium term, we need to begin to transform how we work. And we must keep our eyes on the horizon, because in the longer term, we also need to fundamentally change how we think about the delivery of health and care, driving investment in prevention and early intervention. Because our vision also reveals the complexity of the task before us. Without improving our nation's general health, no end of service improvements or clinical strategies or refined operating models will be able to make us a healthier nation in the long run. That is why prevention is key. We want to shift the balance of care closer to people's homes and drive a proactive approach of early intervention and prevention. This will be underpinned by the principles of accessibility, addressing health inequalities, maximising outcomes and promoting innovation, as well as value for money. In urgent and unscheduled care, a lot has already been done, working with the Scottish Ambulance Service, NHS 24 and through the creation of flow navigation centres to manage demand. Our continued investment in hospital at home will help to increase the provision of acute care at home and ensure patients receive personalised care. We also need to look at the long-term reforms that are going to be required. We are developing a population health framework, taking a cross-government, cross-sector approach to improve the key building blocks of health. We must also recognise the vital role of social care and unpaid carers, supporting people to remain in their own homes for longer. And this is a cross-government preventative approach. We are supporting low-income households, delivering the Scottish Child Payment, delivering Best Start Bright Futures to tackle child poverty and expanding free school meals. We will continue minimum unit pricing, take forward radical action to reduce the harm caused by smoking. I'm also clear that as a nation, all of us need to take personal responsibility and do what we can to mind our own health, pay due attention to nutrition, to our mental health and to exercise, whatever form that may take. Our service reforms must take a whole system approach, including social care and the planned National Care Service. Primary care, the crucial bedrock of the NHS and the key to driving sustainable, effective, good value for money healthcare, has a well-established collaborative programme of reform and improvement already underway. Primary care reform is focused around seeing the right person in the right time, in the right place, and is key to realising a community-first approach. So improving access to primary care, shifting care to the community, is and must be a key focus of reform. This includes our NHS dental payment reform, free universal NHS-funded eye examinations, our NHS Pharmacy First Service, signposting people with common conditions to local pharmacies for advice and treatment. To support general practice, we have significantly expanded the primary care multidisciplinary team workforce with over 4,700 staff working in services including physiotherapy, pharmacy and phlebotomy. We are supporting development of these teams through investment of £190 million in the Primary Care Improvement Fund this year, as well as continuing to support practice learning time. There are ongoing issues we need to continue to address. People whose discharge from hospital is delayed are not receiving the best care that they need, and this can have significant consequences for them as well as the entire system. We've already put in place the Delayed Discharge and Hospital Occupancy Action Plan to help create necessary capacity, but we still need to improve the flow of patients through our hospitals, and we'll work closely with all stakeholders to achieve this. In 2021, the Independent Review of Adult Social Care showed the clear need for change, recommending a reform of social care in Scotland and strengthening national accountability for social care support. The National Care Services Bill, which will ensure greater transparency in the delivery of community health and social care, improve standards, strengthen the role of the workforce and provide better support for unpaid carers, is the biggest public sector reform since devolution. People at the heart of this reform, ending the inconsistency of care provision across Scotland, ensuring those who need it have access to consistently high-quality care and support, and instilling fair work principles for our workforce. Reform is also taking place within our mental health services, which we will continue to invest in, and will shortly see the publication of the delivery plan for the new Mental Health and Capacity Reform Programme. This is the first important step in ensuring that the law and our policies and practices ensure that anyone who requires support is treated fairly and with dignity. And this is just one aspect of our work to improve mental health support at all levels, and we'll continue to work closely with COSLA, health boards and other partners to implement the delivery plans we published last year. Our valued healthcare workforce is, of course, a key part to our vision for reform. In addition to the ongoing implementation of Agenda for Change, we are working with the BMA on junior doctor contract reform, and we have launched the Ministerial Task Force on Nursing and Midwifery, which covers attraction, education and training, retention and staff wellbeing. I'll give way one last time to Finlay Carson.
Finlay Carson.
I very much appreciate giving away. Last week we heard from midwives and the struggles they face during training. What consideration have you given to apprenticeships for midwives and other healthcare workers to help them transition maybe from one career into supporting areas, particularly in rural areas like Dumfries and Galloway?
Through the Chair, Cabinet Secretary, I can give the time
back. Officer, I think Finlay Carson touches upon an important area which has been tested and worked upon through the Nursing and Midwifery Task Force, which is around attraction and retention, the roots in to the professions that we want to see, we need to see expansion on, and also how we can make sure, as Finlay Carson rightly says, we do so on an equitable basis across Scotland so that we can see services improved in rural areas as well. The Health and Care Staffing Scotland Act 2019, introduced in April, is the first comprehensive multidisciplinary workforce planning legislation in Scotland, the most comprehensive of its kind in the UK. And we have recognised the vital role of the social care workforce with a pay uplift to £12 per hour for adult social care workers in commissioned services. Alongside that support for the workforce wellbeing, productivity and support into service, our reforms can and must be accelerated and enriched by the transformative potential of scientific innovation. Last week, the Deputy First Minister and I co-chaired a roundtable on game-changing technologies. The event brought together key leaders from the life sciences industry, as well as academics, the NHS and government, to discuss advances in science and technology that can transform lives and the promotion and implementation of service. Medical research is moving faster than ever. New preventative technologies are supporting people to manage their own health better and prevent and mitigate disease. Wearable devices are helping people to take ownership over their own health, while new diagnostic and screening methods can support the NHS identify and treat disease before symptoms appear. There is a huge future potential in personalised and precision medicine and gene therapies, as well as robotic surgery. So we will proceed with a new partnership based between government, the NHS, our academic institutions and the life sciences industry to focus on seizing the opportunities to empower patients, liberate clinicians, drive efficiencies and prevent ill health. And I'm pleased today to announce that five Scottish institutions, the Universities of Aberdeen, Edinburgh, St Andrews and Strathclyde, as well as Public Health Scotland, have been awarded £1 million of funding each through the Chief Scientist's Office to conduct major research programmes into areas of population health in Scotland. The five programmes awarded funding have the potential to make a significant impact. So, Presiding Officer, I'm aware there are voices in this chamber who have already called for structural change, but I think the urgency of the change required and the focus must be on the transformation of services within the current structures and maximising current assets. So I will work to implement an NHS Scotland approach to harness greater levels of collaboration in our health boards and partners, resulting in better value, quality and outcomes for patients and staff. And that will be led through a government-led national engagement, which we must make sure we are fully committed to the series of engagements which can inform our plans, led through a person-centred approach, but obviously making sure we utilise the incredible work of our workforce. We've established a primary and community health steering group, bringing together a range of health stakeholder partners, and an expert reference group will be convened this autumn, providing independent input, advice and an additional independent international perspective. A stakeholder advisory group will also bring together a cross-section of professional associations, COSLA, the Alliance, regulators and others in service delivery, and I look forward to hearing directly from them to translate the vision into delivery across the system. We will also listen to all voices, and by the end of the year I hope to have brought them to bear in the actions we take. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, there is no more important issue to a nation than the health of its people. I am not looking to publish another strategy. Our work is already being guided by multiple plans, notably the National Clinical Strategy of 2016. Our task now centres on listening and delivery. So I'm pleased, privileged to open this debate today, welcome all contributions and move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Sandy Gulhani to speak to and move Amendment 13466.2, around 8 minutes. Dr. Gulhani.
I wish to draw a member's attention to my register of interest as a practicing NHS GP. The future of our National Health Service is of the utmost importance to the people of Scotland and of over 180,000 serving NHS staff. In fact, healthcare professionals and patient groups have been calling for a national conversation on the NHS for years, and we know why. As our population ages, as more people suffer from chronic diseases, mobility issues, poor mental health, as life expectancy in Scotland falls, as arthritis and musculoskeletal problems affect one-third of our population, with Scots in the most deprived areas twice as likely to die from cancer, one in seven Scots on NHS waiting lists, accident and emergency waiting targets unmet in 4 years, cancer referral standards unmet in a decade, and with the number of whole-time equivalent GPs decreasing at a time when the number of registered patients is growing, this debate is long overdue. And ideally, this debate should transcend politics. The Scottish Conservatives were prepared for this crucial conversation early in February when we published our paper, Modern, Efficient, Local. Since then, the SNP government has been conspicuously silent. They have yet to bring a coherent vision to the table. The SNP is devoid of substantive proposals. Presiding officer, this is not just disappointing, it is a neglect of duty. Instead of stepping up to the plate, either publishing a plan before the opposition or at least responding to our call for a national conversation, the Scottish Government chose to bide its time. Now, I appreciate it was somewhat distracted by the forced change of Health Secretary, but if the SNP spent more time and energy thinking about the NHS than its own travails or a colleague's roaming bills or its politics with the Greens, then maybe, just maybe, we could get serious about NHS reform. And so here we are today. In the midst of a heated general election campaign, the SNP have suddenly decided to bring this crucial debate to chamber. Yet the timing is no accident. It coincides with the SNP's general election headline on the NHS. And despite clear reservations from the two largest opposition parties, the SNP has chosen to manipulate Scottish parliamentary time to serve their own UK general electioneering purposes. This is an affront to every Scot who relies on the NHS and to every healthcare professional who dedicates their life to serving others. Presiding officer, this is not the time for crafty manoeuvres or underhanded tactics. This is the time for honest, robust and urgent dialogue about how we ensure the NHS can continue to provide world-class care. Despite the SNP and the political shenanigans, we come today armed with ideas and with a willingness to engage in constructive dialogue. Our vision for an NHS in Scotland that is modern, efficient, local, accessible for all of our population, urban, rural, island. To achieve this, our country will need to truly embrace innovation and change. I will, yes.
Ruth Maguire.
I appreciate Sandesh Gulhani giving way. Does the Conservative vision for healthcare include it remaining in public hands?
Sandesh Gulhani.
100%, and as an NHS GP, I would always want the NHS to be free at the point of care. And in fact, if you listen a little bit longer, you'll hear some of our great ideas. And if you read Modern, Efficient, Local,
through the chair,
our vision of the NHS, then the member would be able to understand our 26 pages worth of policy document. To achieve this, our country will need to truly embrace innovation and change, plus take the strain off our health service and its staff. This way, we can maintain our health service and its staff. This way, we can maintain universal healthcare as we know it. To start with, we want to strengthen primary care so practices can both handle the volume of demand and carry out the type of clinical interventions that are safe and practical to deliver in the community. This includes backing our community pharmacists, optometrists, audiology services, physio, links workers, and they all have the expertise to support community-based care. This should have happened under the GP contract, but with all things, the SNP have broken their promise and failed to deliver. To achieve this, we would reprioritise resources and, in plain speak, We would radically increase the percentage of the NHS budget that funds primary care. Our vision of a modern, efficient health service also embraces innovation. We want to see clinicians, university researchers, data scientists, AI technologists, government and industry in lockstep to develop monitoring, diagnostic and advanced therapy. We need to use technology to predict problems, because if we can predict, we can prevent and so protect people. We must also deploy technology to reduce inefficiencies.
Cabinet Secretary.
Sandesh Gulhani for giving way, and I really want to focus in on the ideas for how we move forward, and his suggestion around how we refocus and prioritise some of the funding into prevention and primary service, I agree with. However, how we do that at a time of constrained public finance is the conundrum that we're all facing, isn't it? So I would welcome Sandesh Gulhani's suggestion of that, whilst there is a continued spending restraint coming from the UK government, which would mean that we don't see services in the acute sector and the secondary care sector suffering as a result of that reprioritisation.
Sandesh Gulhani, I can give you the time back for those interventions.
Well, what we would see, Cabinet Secretary, is a reduction in demand in secondary care, which is far more expensive than the work we would undertake in primary care. And we also need to be cognizant of the fact that over the 17 years of SNP government, there is £17 billion in Barnett consequentials that haven't been spent on the health service. We would adopt more data science and AI solutions to be more efficient at handling surgery schedule, managing staff rotas, ordering equipment and consumables. Adopting medical technology solutions at scale would help us better manage patient care, shorten hospital stays, reduce hospital readmission rates, improve patient satisfaction and achieve better patient outcomes. In rural and island areas, this would include mobile screening services, taking diagnostics to the community, such as lung screening, instead of expecting patients to travel long distances. We could use AI to speed up the reading of x-rays, CTs and MRI scans. And this would complement, not replace, doctors. We would also ensure that NHS management better supports our clinical staff. Workforce terms and conditions must work for those on the front line and their families. Good staff morale is absolutely vital to how we retain great people and make the NHS an attractive option for our bright school leavers. We would also remove the false cap on the number of medical students at Scotland's universities, subject to each medical school's capacity, allowing a greater number of qualified Scots to become medics. But across our population, we must really make and take greater responsibilities for our own health. Our NHS cannot continue to act as a repair shop when things go wrong. We need a service that's far more focused on keeping us healthier for longer. Of course, the Scottish Conservatives have brought solutions to the table before. Almost 3 years ago, I proposed a solution for tackling long COVID, but this was ignored. The then Health Secretary, who went on to be First Minister, while the number of Scots suffering with this debilitating condition grew to over 180,000, 10% of them children. Now, let's not have a repeat of this inaction. We are calling for a serious, focused and sincere national conversation about the NHS that is free from the taint of electoral scheming and dedicated solely to finding out sustainable solutions for the future. Presiding Officer, I move the Scottish Conservatives motion in my name.
Thank you, Dr. Gulhani. And I now call on Jackie Bailey to speak to and move Amendment 13466.1. Ms. Bailey, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I have to say, I think this debate has been misnamed. It is, of course, entitled The Vision for Health and Social Care, but this SNP government has not had any vision for health and social care for the last 17 years. And for those who don't believe me, here are the words from Audit Scotland in their damning report on the state of the NHS from earlier this year. And I quote, "There are a range of strategies, plans and policies in place, but no overall vision. The absence of a shared national vision and a clear strategy to deliver it makes it more difficult for NHS boards to plan for change." So there you have it. Up to now, the SNP's past two health secretaries have resisted the BMA's repeated requests for a national conversation. Now that we are on to our third health secretary, I can only assume that the sudden change of heart is that the SNP are indeed bereft of ideas and need some help. Now, let me say as a matter of record, the Scottish Labour Party is happy to help because we care too much about the NHS not to do so. But can I gently point out to the Cabinet Secretary that the BMA, RCN, Unison, the GMB, all of the Royal Colleges, the social care sector, and even us politicians have been offering suggestions for years. And here is the rub. Even when we do make suggestions, the SNP are incapable of implementing them properly. Let me cite the National Care Service as one such example. First proposed by Labour more than a decade ago, rejected by the SNP, and now suddenly it's their big idea. But the problem is that their plans are all about structures. They're not about raising quality, and they're not about improving culture, which is essential. And of course, not one penny is going on care just now, at a time when we have 9,000 people waiting to be assessed for care and existing care packages are being savagely slashed right the way across the country. So I think there is no doubt in anyone's mind about the scale of the crisis facing the NHS in Scotland. It is profound. Hardworking staff across the health and social care sector are doing their very best to care for us, but they are burnt out and they are demoralised. Vacancy levels amongst nurses and doctors are higher than they should be. The use of agency staff to cover shifts in social care is increasing, and GPs are struggling to cope with increasing demand as the numbers of new GPs promised have failed to materialise. The NHS and social care, we can all agree, are nothing without the staff. So we owe them a huge debt of gratitude, but we also owe them better workforce planning and an increase in training places. The government does need to urgently review the process of workforce planning, and whilst it is doing so, it needs to make better efforts to retain existing staff. And we're happy to make suggestions in this area. But then there is the lack of access to mental health support. Delayed discharge rising, failure to meet cancer treatment targets, and the ever-growing waiting lists for treatment. And when you add in the £1.4 billion in cuts that health boards and health and social care partnerships are making, the picture will get even worse. Indeed, when the SNP came to power, spending on health was 17% per head of the population higher than in England, and now it's only 3%. The SNP have eroded spending over time, so it's little wonder that life expectancy has dropped on their watch. And I'm happy to give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
Grateful to Jackie Bailey for giving way. I'm interested in the waiting time statistics that Jackie Bailey quotes within her amendment, because they are factually inaccurate. And I'm interested in understanding how she has arrived at the figure of 840,000 people on an NHS waiting list, because that is not borne out by the figures demonstrated from Public Health Scotland. How has she arrived at those misleading and factually inaccurate statistics?
Jackie Bailey.
Well, first, let me say they're not misleading. They're not factually inaccurate. These figures are taken from Public Health Scotland published data. So let me now focus on waiting times, because I think this is the most obvious sign of failure from the SNP. The fact that we have 840,000 Scots languishing on waiting lists for tests, for diagnosis and for treatment is absolutely shameful. That is one in six of the population. That's somebody you know, that's a family member or a friend. And it is a national scandal. Now, when Humza Yousaf was the health secretary, he announced targets to eradicate the longest waits, reducing them to below 2 years for outpatients and inpatients by August and September 2022. Almost 2 years on, none of these targets have been met. Not a single one of them. And instead of reducing the number of people waiting, is going up, an extra 77,000 in the last year alone. Now, part of the solution suggested by the SNP that we supported, and they announced in 2015, were national treatment centres. But now they've been paused indefinitely in Ayrshire and Arran, in Tayside, in Grampian, in Lothian and Lanarkshire. So what will the SNP do instead? But it's clear that the recovery plan is not working. Waiting times are going up. More people are waiting. So I would recommend that the Cabinet Secretary tears it up and starts again. But before closing, Presiding Officer, I want to deal with comments made by Stephen Flynn, suggesting that Labour want to privatise the NHS is both disgusting and dishonest, and frankly desperate as he struggles to save his seat in the election. Perhaps he wasn't aware of the SNP's own record in government. The total number of private hospital admissions in Scotland in 2023 was 46,000, 11% higher than in 2022, 32% higher than in 2019. More private admissions this year than in any previous year on record, and the majority paid for by the SNP government. Shockingly, self-pay admissions are up 8% and at their highest level since records began. So it is the SNP that are presiding over a two-tier health service. It is the SNP that have failed to get to grips with the crisis in our NHS. The NHS is in crisis. The SNP have no idea how to turn it around. It's not just time for new ideas. It's time for a new government, because this one is incapable of making things work. In 1948, Labour created the NHS. In 1997, we rescued the NHS. And now on the 5th of July, 2024, on the 76th birthday of the NHS, we will rescue it again. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call on Gillian Mackay, around 6 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by extending my gratitude to the workers that make up our NHS, those who spend their lives making sure that we get the care we're entitled to when we need it. This includes every single worker involved in the running of our services, from the nurses and GPs to the cleaners, cooks and ambulance drivers. The same goes to the countless carers that keep our social care system afloat, and I hope this can serve as a reminder that there is no NHS and no social care without these very people, and that their tireless contributions must continue to be valued. There is only so much we can cover in the Chamber today, and I acknowledge that this should be the start of a wider conversation. We need to be clear that the work to fundamentally reform and improve our services must come on different fronts, and each set of issues will require different timelines. I also believe that we cannot have a candid conversation about reform without acknowledging the very context in which our health and social care systems exist. We cannot ignore the injustice of Brexit and the impact it's had on our workforce. It has gutted our services and our ability to retain talented individuals. The fiscal constraints placed on us due to austerity from Westminster, the ripple effect from the pandemic, an ageing population and a high burden of non-communicable disease puts the NHS here in Scotland in a particularly fragile place. We have to acknowledge that this is the reality we're operating in. This, however, doesn't absolve the government from its responsibilities, and I bring these factors up rather to inform our dialogue and to have an open and frank conversation based on the reality we're facing, because it is all too easy to ignore the collective burden of these factors. I believe that reform must focus on a more sustainable healthcare system, performance improvement, prevention, providing quality services and maximising access. A non-negotiable is the preservation of a publicly owned system free at the point of use. We must not allow ourselves to be buoyed by a false narrative that privatising key aspects of our NHS would fix its difficulties. Scotland's fought hard against privatisation since devolution, and I urge the Cabinet Secretary to continue this fight, and I was pleased to see this reflected in the motion today. I believe that we have to focus on prevention, reform and waiting times as three targets to help to solve the issues we're currently facing. And I want to focus firstly on prevention. I'm aware that we cannot prevent all ill health from ever happening, but given we recorded 53,000 deaths in 2021 attributed to non-communicable diseases, we should as a nation aspire to reduce preventable ill health to the lowest level possible, putting a real value on health and ensuring everyone has a good, healthy life for as long as possible. This in itself will reduce pressure on the NHS overall. This isn't a quick fix and won't necessarily show up quickly in statistics, but the little bits we can all do over time take pressure off the NHS and improve many lives across the country. As an example, yesterday I attended the Walking Football Scotland and Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland Tartan and Teapot Trophy at Heriot Watt University, as did the Minister for Sport. The number of people taking part is phenomenal, with around 90 teams playing in the Walking Football Scottish Cup later this month. There are benefits for physical health. Many who play are older and have stopped playing five-a-sides for a variety of reasons. This different style of play helps keep people active longer when they may have otherwise given up sport. They also contribute to better mental well-being and preventing isolation, and I was reliably informed yesterday that if you wanted to, you could play walking football 5 days a week. That's hugely accessible for those who may have retired and could become isolated, and it is a lot harder to do than it looks. We need to make sure that organisations and initiatives like these have the funding they need to deliver these services, because the reach of many of these organisations is far beyond anything that we could design here. We also need to invest in GP services. Securing the future of our NHS and improving the health of Scotland fundamentally depends on increasing the number of GPs. Short-term fixes where need is particularly acute must be complemented with long-term strategic planning from the Scottish Government to tackle the severe workforce crisis. We also need to see protected learning time for GPs and their teams, and I'm pleased to see this inclusion in the Government motion and want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for our conversation around this. We all know that time is a huge barrier in primary care. Learning and improving knowledge at the moment has to fit in around everything else that's happening in a GP surgery. And I'm very sure that much of the learning that's happening is happening in clinicians' own time. Allowing time to update and share knowledge can only serve to provide better outcomes for patients. We need to also ensure the action we take here to create a good food and drink environment to ensure that people have a real choice to improve their health. I've said before that some of the action we need to take to improve health is a whole government approach. Poverty, as we know, is a big barrier to health, a universal basic income, and putting more money in people's pockets has to be part of that. But taking action to encourage reformulation of products, taking action to ban disposable vapes, reduce smoking and tackle other health-harming products has to be part of the landscape. In my opinion, we also need a public health levy to ensure that in a time where funding for services is tight, we are ensuring that those selling products that damage health are contributing to the services that pick up the pieces. I was hugely pleased that we secured the commitment to explore a public health levy in this year's budget. I think it's essential that work comes forward quickly on this. With the current financial situation and the acute need in public services, I believe it would be negligent of any government to not maximise the funding coming into services, and this is a relatively easy way to do that. There is so much work to do in individual specialisms within secondary care that need to change quickly to get waiting lists down, but I do believe a fundamental part of the reform agenda for health has to solidly focus on reducing ill health overall. Once again, Presiding Officer, I'd like to extend my deepest gratitude to the tireless workers that drive our health and social care services. Without them, we have no NHS.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. As somebody who's played walking football, I would be concerned that playing walking football 5 days a week may put additional pressure on A&E services. But anyway, I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton, around 6 minutes. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Well, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to speak for the Liberal Democrats in today's debate, and I'm grateful for the meeting the Cabinet Secretary offered me. I know he met with others as well in advance of today to talk about building consensus. I welcome that. But as I told him at that meeting, our NHS is still in crisis. He knows it. We know it. The people working on the front line that Gillian Martin and Mackay has just rightly thanked know it. And many of us have spoken of it in this chamber on countless occasions. Under 17 years of SNP government, the fundamentals of our health service have been steadily eroded. Those who work in it, those who rely on it, are suffering greatly as a result. We are asking far too much of our hardworking staff. They are all going above and beyond repeatedly and have done for years. I must take issue with the fact that the Cabinet Secretary referenced the safe staffing legislation that we all passed in the last session of Parliament. But even tonight, there will be shifts right across the NHS, in hospital wards, in every health board in the country that are unsafe, that are not staffed safely, where clinicians are not safe and patients are not safe. And we have yet to live up to the full spirit and fundamentals of that act. Across the board, clinicians, nurses, patients, ancillary workers have all been let down. Take primary care as an example. Many Scots are old enough to remember a time when if you needed your GP, you could book an appointment, be seen within a couple of days. That is almost an undiscovered country now. Now, routinely, people have to make dozens, hundreds of phone calls just to speak to someone at their GP practice. I spoke to a woman in Caithness 2 weeks ago who phoned 200 times when the phones opened at 8:30 before being finally given an appointment 3 weeks after. And it's not just there, it's happening everywhere. And I've even heard of people being told they'd have to wait 2 weeks to get an appointment for a baby. For a baby, if you're a young parent, that's a terrible amount of time to wait. And I've said many times, I've lent into the words of Dr. Andrew Bewis, who is chair of the BMA's Scottish GP committee recently, who said, we are often told that GPs are the bedrock of the NHS, but that bedrock is crumbling, and it is the patients who will suffer. Patients are indeed suffering. Hundreds of thousands of patients in Scotland are languishing on waiting lists for tests or for treatment. We've heard harrowing tales of people waiting hours in pain for an ambulance to arrive. And just last month, you'll remember, presiding officer, I raised at first minister's questions, along with Douglas Ross, the case on Sky of a woman who nearly died on the doorstep of Portree Hospital because all the doors were locked at her time of asphyxiation when her boyfriend was throwing rocks at the windows, despite a report 6 years ago telling the SNP government to keep that hospital open for 24/7 care. And what about the thousands of Scots, many of them children, who are suffering with their mental ill health as part of the long shadow of lockdown? They're forced to join the longest queue for treatment in our National Health Service. The motion for today's debate states, and I quote, the importance of continuing to invest in mental health services. And I could almost laugh at that if it wasn't so desperate. Well, because in previous budget negotiations, my party secured £120 million extra for mental health, but the SNP have seen fit to cut in real terms spending on mental health by nearly £80 million. With our young people still struggling with the legacy of those lockdowns, any mental health practitioner in the country will tell you that the government could not have picked a worse time to let that funding slip away. And just today, mental health treatment targets were missed yet again. Scotland needs world-class mental health services, and the Scottish Liberal Democrats will fight to see them delivered. That's why we've set out plans to increase the tax paid by social media giants and use that money to help fund more mental health support in schools and get more professionals closer to where people live. Presiding officer, this is very much a polluter pays principle. We know the ecosystems created by social media are the environments in which people are suffering abuse, dealing with body image issues, and it's one that they find it increasingly difficult to escape. So those people who create that ecosystem should pay. This government has been out of ideas for patients and staff alike, so it's no wonder then they're finding it harder than ever to attract and retain new staff. We need experienced staff now more than ever if we're to bring down those waiting lists. But rather than making the meaningful investment our health service need, this government is relying on short-term fixes to plug the gaps. Instead, it's pursuing its plans for an unwanted ministerial takeover of social care. It's little more than a bureaucratic exercise, but it will cost billions of pounds and does nothing to address the issues, the fundamental issues in social care, which are leading to delayed discharges in our hospitals and creating that interruption in flow throughout the NHS. Scottish Liberal Democrats want staff to be fairly paid and fairly treated with good working conditions. And the government can make progress by adopting our burnout prevention strategy and setting up an NHS staff assembly so our doctors and nurses can put their voices and their expertise at the heart of the solution. Presiding officer, patients need to know they will be tested, diagnosed and treated in a timely fashion when they seek care of our health service, so as to have the best chance of recovery. That's all they're asking for and they're right to expect it. The competent management of our health service is perhaps the primary thing we elect a Scottish government to do. In fact, it's what Neil Gray said as much in his closing remarks, that some people are being forced to pay for private treatment to get well is emblematic of how bad things have got. I'm glad to see the government making time for this debate and health and social care in this chamber. In truth, it's been given far too little time by the government in recent months. And I welcome the sentiment expressed by the Health Secretary. I hate to be pessimistic, but we have heard it all before. Each of his many predecessors have promised much but delivered little. People are sick to the back teeth of being taken for granted. They need new hope and they need change. And in his heart of hearts, the Health Secretary must know that any new vision for health and social care in Scotland has to be one that does not involve his party. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Sue Webber. Around 6 minutes, Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The NHS in Scotland, our publicly owned, publicly run, free at the point of use National Health Service, is one of our country's greatest assets. For over seven decades, it has served Scotland through thick and thin, even in a pandemic, looking after folk from the cradle to the grave and nothing in between. In years to come, I look forward to being able to talk about it alongside the National Care Service that is currently being set up by this SNP government. The establishment of a National Care Service is a huge undertaking, but it is just one part of the reforms that we need to be looking at within health and social care if we want to ensure it is sustainable in the long term. That sits alongside targeted investments such as the £190 million in multidisciplinary teams to support GPs. When it comes to health, the answer is not just to throw money at the private sector, or as Wes Streeton has said Labour will do, throw the NHS to the private sector. I firmly believe at the heart of all the issues faced by the NHS, in whichever part of the UK it is, Westminster austerity and the £18 to £30 billion of cuts contained in both Labour and Tory spending plans are now what threatens its very future. When it comes to the future of the NHS in Scotland, it is in the best hands possible when it is in public hands. But how we fund that NHS and how we balance that with spending on a range of other policies that impact folks' health is a difficult balancing act. Whether or not we choose to admit it, the question of how much a life is worth runs through so many of the decisions that are made in this place, not just in healthcare. And the answer probably varies between what policy area money is being spent in. In our NHS, the nature of what it does means that we can just about identify every life it saves and every life that it couldn't save. When it comes to approving treatments, there's even a measure used that comes as close as you will get to answering that question, where they consider quality adjusted life years when making the most difficult decisions about allocating resources. But if we look elsewhere in government, it becomes that much harder to pinpoint the individuals that these life and death decisions affect. For example, if we invest in improving road safety and road fatalities go down, you're never going to know who it was that didn't crash. Conversely, we know that poverty and poor air quality shortens lives. But are we going to see that listed on a death certificate? Initiatives like the Scottish Child Payment and low emission zones may go on to play as much of a role in keeping folk healthy and tackling health inequalities as some parts of our NHS. Scrapping the child cap would have a similar impact that wouldn't just give more bairns a better chance at life, it would likely mean that they go on to live a longer and healthier one too. Presiding Officer, I'm not suggesting that reform of the NHS be quite that wide-ranging. But as we look at reform, it is worth recognising the role that prevention can play and how not every intervention needs to involve a doctor. I know a lot of folk who view their GP as their only point of contact for everything, and that is a reflection of the capabilities of those GPs and the esteem that they are held in. However, some will insist on seeing their GP even when nurses, physiotherapists or other medical professionals are better placed to help them. But that multidisciplinary approach is the way forward, and it is starting to become more common and more accepted. It is also something that can be built on. An example of that good practice that I've seen working well in my own constituency, and which I think other health boards would do well to look at, is the Grampian Eye Network. It's an initiative that sends folk with eye difficulties to an optometrist in the first instance. It takes pressure off GPs and A&E departments, and it means that patients can get a much more appropriate diagnosis or referral from someone who specialises in looking after eyes and deals with them day in and day out. Presiding Officer, nobody is saying our NHS is perfect, and there is work that needs to be done and improvements that can be made. And this motion acknowledges that reform is needed and is looking forward to how those improvements are delivered. But let me finish by talking up the state of the NHS in Scotland. Under SNP government's NHS funding has more than doubled to £19.5 billion this year. We've worked with trade unions to avoid a single day of strike action over pay. NHS staffing is at a record high, with 31,300 more doctors, nurses and other staff than in 2007. Per head of population compared to England, we have more doctors, more nurses and midwives, more hospital consultants, more GPs, more dentists and more NHS staff overall. And we are continuing to invest in training even more staff, with 880 more junior doctor training posts created since 2014. The NHS will stay in safe hands and in public hands under this SNP government. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dunbar. And I call Sue Webber to be followed by Christine Graham, around 6 minutes. Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our NHS is an incredible national asset. I don't think anyone doubts that, but it continues to face growing challenges. The SNP's consistent attempts to blame their NHS failures on the UK government lack credibility. They have, after all, full control over healthcare. Yet here we are, with over 840,000 Scottish people waiting on an NHS waiting list. In March 2024, almost a third of patients had to wait over 4 hours in A&E. Just 71.1% of cancer patients are seen within 62 days. And since the SNP promised to increase the number of GPs by 800 by 2027, GP numbers have actually decreased by 42. Right now, we have over 4,000 nursing vacancies in NHS Scotland, and in 2023, NHS staff faced around 31 assaults a day. I could go on, but we've heard these statistics many times before, and I'm sure we'll hear them again in this debate this afternoon. The only way to bring down waiting lists is to be more efficient with the resources we have, or create more capacity to do more. Just imagine what we could do if we could do both. And here's what I mean by more efficient. I recently spoke to a surgeon that operates across two different hospitals. In one hospital, the theatre is staffed with tens of nurses and ODPs, and they do two cases, maybe three if they're lucky, on a list. In the other, there are far fewer staff, yet in each theatre, on one list, they can do 6 to 8 cases, faster patient turnarounds, less the delays between cases. That is more efficient. So imagine how we could bring down waiting lists if this was compounded with increased capacity. To me, it's blindingly obvious that the decision taken by the SNP government to stop all new capital investment in our NHS will be catastrophic. The SNP Scottish Government appear to favour short-term solutions that will have devastating long-term consequences for our NHS. As Jackie Bailey said, we were promised 11 new regional treatment centres that were intended to bring down the waiting lists. Now the website mentions only 4. In addition to these treatment centres, dozens of NHS construction projects across Scotland have been stopped, and vital projects here in Lothian have been postponed. And these include a new cancer centre, a new eye hospital, a national treatment centre in Livingston, and a GP surgery in East Calder, crying out for a new facility, has been all but abandoned. And that's before we talk about community hospitals closing in and around the area. With a growing population and diminishing resources, the new chief executive of NHS Lothian has a real challenge ahead of her. But for a moment, let's focus on the preventative healthcare. Right now, for every £1 we spend on our NHS, we spend just 2 pence on public health. Investing in prevention has substantial benefits for reducing patient demand and cost, as does early diagnosis and treatment, which keeps treatment costs down, has far better patient outcomes, and gets people back to work having a far better quality of life. So we need to greatly increase spending on these public health interventions if we are to make prevention the overall strategy of our approach towards healthcare. And we all know the success that the smoking ban had in the immediate aftermath after its introduction. Arthritis and other musculoskeletal conditions affect one-third of Scotland's population. That's 1.7 million of us. And just last week, we saw the publication of record NHS waiting times, with trauma and orthopaedic waits being the single largest cohort, making up a third of all waits. I am one of those 1.7 million, and I'm far too young to be getting new knees just yet, but I have been in chronic pain and in significant medication to manage that pain, and that medication is not free. It costs money. Yesterday, I went to the GP for my second injection in my knees, though, so now I've had them both done, and almost immediately after my hyaluronic acid injection, I experienced a significant reduction in pain, I've increased mobility, and I'm not taking the medication anymore, which will have many health benefits. But here in Lothian, there are very long waits for those joint injections. I've been very unfortunate to have a GP that can do this, and I want to give a thank out to Dr. Graham Parry in Collington Surgery. I've also met a physio who told me how important physios can play in the roles with people with arthritic joints. Yet the Chartered Society for Physiotherapy has highlighted a worsening workforce crisis in physiotherapy with record high vacancy rates, with 1 in 5 physiotherapists considering leaving the profession. And this is a key profession in terms of getting elderly patients who are stuck in hospital more mobile and able to function themselves, which would free up beds in hospital, make up appointments and space for other activities to take place. And if you really want to talk about preventative spend, I want to speak about a rare and incurable genetic condition affecting spinal motor nerves called spinal muscular atrophy, SMA, which, unless caught early, results in progressive muscle wasting and weakness. With approximately 1 in 16,000 British babies born with SMA, the case for adding it to the newborn screening blood spot test for all newborns is obvious to me. And I noticed Mr. Doris is in the chamber today, and I know he cares passionately about this too. Yes, that test will cost money, and yes, the treatment will cost money, but the cost of round-the-clock care for someone with SMA is around £500,000 a year. So surely it fits both financially and philosophically with the principle of preventative medicine. On Friday, I met a lady in Collington. Bob Doris.
Bob Doris.
To update the member on... Thank you. It's just to update the member on progress in relation to SMA screening. We had a very successful meeting myself with representative of SMA with the Cabinet Secretary this afternoon. We're not at the forum to get more information on that, but we're very optimistic that progress will indeed be made. The Scottish Government has been very constructive in relation to these matters.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, Mr. Doris, for that update. And on Friday, just on more preventative, I met a lady in Collington called Shona Harrower, and she wanted to tell me about a truly preventative approach from Norway. Amazeballs free sports equipment loan scheme for all under 25s with a residential address in Norway, she proclaimed. Rachel, my daughter, has just sent me this awesome photo from Norway. An old school friend visited her, and they borrowed all the camping gear they needed from the beer shop to make memories like this. If a picture could tell 1,000 words, this one certainly did. Tackling both physical and mental health at the same time, getting our young people involved in sport and nature. What is not to like there? The NHS in Scotland has been described as sustainable in its current form by Professor Paul Gray, the former head of the NHS in Scotland. The SNP have driven that NHS into the crisis. They must adopt the Scottish Conservatives' proposals for a modern, efficient local healthcare to secure the future of our NHS in Scotland.
Thank you. I call Christine Graham to be followed by Elena Whittam.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is choosing to invest more than £19.5 billion in health and social care in 2024-25, giving our NHS a real terms uplift in the face of UK government austerity. And I understand NHS funding comprises almost 40% of the government's budget. It has more than doubled under this government, and staffing is at a record high, as a colleague has said, with far more doctors and nurses per head in Scotland than in England. The government, working with trade unions, prevented a single day of strike action over pay in our health service, unlike elsewhere in the UK. We all know it has an increasing ageing population, with therefore increasing demands on health and social care, and the fallout from COVID continues to add pressure to NHS services. But now to the financial context. Sandesh Gulhani and Jackie Bailey conveniently sidestepped that. There is a perfect financial storm, which started with austerity under the Tories following the 2008 bank crash and continues to this day. COVID, UK Brexit with its costs, raging inflation peaking at 11% brought about by the disastrous Liz Truss budget, natural wage demands as a consequence, energy inflation as a result of Ukraine's invasion by Russia, but compounded by a failure of UK governments to invest in homegrown energy over decades, having squandered North Sea oil revenues, unlike independent Norway. So before we tackle reform, let's lay some myths to rest. And follow the money is a good place to start. If any UK government makes public sector cuts, then because of Barnett consequentials, we suffer too. This is significant when I refer to Labour's plans, should it come to power, For example, if more health is delivered through the private sector, public funding decreases in England, so funding devolved to Scotland decreases. When this government is determined to keep the NHS in public hands. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Sue Webber.
Just waiting. Thank you for taking that intervention. The spending is not ring-fenced. If an NHS in England chooses to contract a private provider to provide a service for them, the money still comes to Scotland as a consequence. It is not, as the member is saying, given in that manner.
Christine Graham.
I think, with respect, the member better check how the money is allocated to Scotland. Labour's Shadow Health Secretary has admitted, when it comes to NHS funding, Westminster is damaging Scotland's NHS because of Westminster austerity that we've suffered for 14 years. Rachel Reeves, the Shadow Chancellor, has indicated that the Labour Party, if it is elected to office, will not increase income tax, national insurance, corporation tax or VAT, and that it has accepted very strict borrowing limits within very strict fiscal and tax rules and squeezed spending budgets. Does it have several money trees? Our spokesperson all said that Labour, quote, wants the NHS to form partnerships with the private sector that goes beyond just hospitals, close quote. And having previously admitted that, quote, holding the door wide open to private interests in the NHS, that to me is privatisation. Private healthcare investors have also stated that the Labour Party would, quote, quick start private sector investment much more proactively than the Tories were able to do. I'll take the member. Is she challenging these quotes?
Carol Mockin.
Thank you. I just wondered if the member has looked at some of the questions, the written questions that I've placed to the Scottish Government about the continued use of private beds in the Scottish system. So, there, you know, I think that we have to think about what is happening in our own system and be realistic about that.
Christine Graham.
I asked the member if she was challenging these quotes. She did not challenge them. Therefore, I adhere to these quotations in the current campaigning run by the Labour Party and Labour-run Wales. The Welsh Finance Minister, Rebecca Evans, said when publishing their draft budget, quote, after 13 years of austerity, a botched Brexit deal and the ongoing cost of living crisis, this is the toughest financial situation Wales has faced since the start of devolution. Our funding settlement, which comes largely from the UK government, is not enough to reflect the extreme pressure Wales faces, close quotes. What is true for Wales is true for Scotland. And top of this, Scotland is still living with the bruising legacy of Labour's PFI in Scotland, Private Finance Initiative. This has landed us with a £30 billion bill handed down to taxpayers by Labour, which built in Scotland on a build now, pay later scheme. The SNP government had to buy out, for example, the contract levying car parking charges at the Edinburgh Royal Infirmary because of the PFI contract. Until we are independent and have control of our own resources. And the stark truth is that Westminster government may change from Tory blue to a Labour lighter shade of blue, but that will be the only change. In conclusion, to quote Labour's Shadow Health Secretary again, one of my favourite people now, Wes Streeting, quote, all roads lead back to Westminster. Yep. The NHS is in crisis. And all decisions that are taken in Westminster don't just affect England, but Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland, close quotes. That should be borne in mind when Labour's proclamations of change mean Labour's creeping NHS privatisation plans with a predictable reduction in Scotland's NHS budget. You can't even firefight, let alone do preventative medicine and treatment in that, because no reform can cope with that.
Thank you, and I call Elena Whittam to be followed by Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Early intervention and prevention is something that I am passionate about across all of the systems that impact on our health and well-being, individually and collectively as a nation. I believed in this ethos before Dr. Campbell Christie's commission, but it has been the guiding principle for all that I've done in the last decade. Today, the government's motion before us puts early intervention and prevention and public service reform at its very heart. We cannot argue the fact that the Scottish Government has increased the NHS workforce by nearly 25% since 2006. We also cannot argue that despite 14 years of austerity and inconsistent funding flowing from Westminster, the Scottish Government is this year providing a record £19.5 billion into the health and social care budgets. But we also cannot fail to recognise that the entire health and social care system urgently needs reformed, because despite these record staffing levels and record funding, people, indeed our communities, are still dealing with health inequalities and access difficulties. And this means we need to engage in an open and honest national discussion about what we want and need from our health and social care system, and how we will navigate the systems and culture changes urgently needed. And this need is exacerbated by COVID and Brexit. Presiding Officer, yesterday I chaired a roundtable discussion at Garvan's Community Hospital, attended by cross-party MSPs, local councillors, community organisations and statutory services. This was brought about by the untimely death of a much-loved local man who passed away despite the heroic efforts from locals, including two off-duty paramedics who worked valiantly for 50 minutes before the ambulance drafted in from Kilmarnock was able to arrive. With a lot of unease in the community about their access to emergency care, a letter was sent to elected members and statutory services bringing the tragic loss to our attention. Now, Garvan and the surrounding villages and hamlets of South Carrick are a resilient population used to working collectively to deal with the rurality of their lives. They have excellent community groups, including the RNLI, a community fire station, and community paramedics. There are many DFIBs across the area, and neighbours look out for each other. They look after each other with the deep-held belief that in their time of need, the state will look after them. Now, I cannot determine if the man's life would have been saved had an ambulance attended within the target time. But if it had, the family and the community would have known that all had been done for him. Yesterday's roundtable discussion was wide-ranging and hard-hitting. We all realise that there are profound equalities issues in rural areas when it comes to access to health and social care services, and indeed across many other areas of public service. There was an acceptance that an ambulance cannot sit in the South Carrick area should there be a critical incident requiring its attendance across the rest of Ayrshire. But it remains the case that when that Garvan ambulance is pulled away, it leaves a vast area without life-saving cover close at hand. We discussed the innovation that has been undertaken by the locality partnership to bring as many NHS services to the Garvan area as possible within the community hospital and health centre. There was a discussion of learning that can be had from successful area-based shared working models, such as that in place in Dalmellington in East Ayrshire and more recently in Dumfries and Galloway. Both of these models also seek to look across all systems, including housing, access to social security, access to exercise, healthy foods and well-being via reductions in poverty and social isolation at all stages of life. Presiding Officer, I believe that the community conversation that was had yesterday is exactly the type of conversations that we need to have across Scotland. We need to move the discussion away from resting only with the decision makers and put them firmly into our town halls and community centres. We need to look at communities and ensure that their assets are recognised and utilised to maximum effect. We need to move the dial towards investing much more in early intervention and prevention to ensure that our children and their children are able to live long, happy and healthy lives. Now, I am concerned by the rhetoric we are hearing during the current political debate that seems to point to very little increased funding for our public services, including the NHS. It feels more like we're going to be shortchanged rather than any real change occurring. Presiding Officer, if we want to truly create a health and social care service that will support an ageing population dealing with entrenched health inequalities that were exacerbated by the COVID pandemic, we're seeing comorbidities increasing. All spheres of government need to recognise that there must be resources available to innovate and intervene early on. Without the investment in early intervention and transformation supported by everyone, we are not going to achieve our collective goal of a robust and resilient health service that's there at the point of need for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Carol Mockin to be followed by Ruth McGuire.
Thank you. Presiding Officer.
And can I begin by saying that it is welcome that this debate has been brought forward in government time today. Discussing the NHS and its future is of critical importance, and it is the case that we must all work to deliver an NHS fit for the 21st century together. Having said this, we absolutely cannot ignore the context in which we have this debate today, nor the challenges facing our NHS in 2024. The SNP want all parties to participate in the discussion about our health service future, and this is welcome. But in order for that to happen, they must recognise their own role in causing the seriously challenging position the NHS finds itself in. Acknowledging one's own mistakes is a key factor. Acknowledging the challenges resulting from government's own approaches is a key factor. I know that some of the backbenchers like to discuss the Labour Party, and I too enjoy discussing the future Labour government. Yeah, yeah. But today's Labour amendment rightly takes the opportunity to set out what is happening here in Scotland. We are now working with 1 in 7 Scots on waiting lists. And I must draw the government and its backbenchers to realise what is happening in Scotland. And I don't say that to have a go at the government. I say that because, going back to my former points about acknowledging the challenges in some of the approaches that have been taken, there are 32% more private hospital admissions since 2019. And spending overall per person has reduced. Now, the member at the back was extremely critical of spending, but we do know that in the early years, John Swinney did not pass on consequentials from a Labour government to the Scottish NHS. Of course.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the member to give way. And of course, the Barnett consequentials flow from expenditure in England in certain specific areas where the same areas are devolved to Scotland. So where money is spent on the NHS, however it is spent on the NHS in England, it will lead to a Barnett consequential coming to Scotland.
Carol Mockin.
Of course, and understanding the system is really important. I'm happy to take the member at the back.
Christine Graham.
The member at the back, thank you for that. It's a new title. I'm quite happy with it. And Carol Mockin is a good socialist like me. Do you have concerns at the noises coming out of Wes Streeting and Rachel Reeves with regards to public services, and in particular regarding privatisation steps within the English NHS, which will impact on Scotland?
Carol Mockin.
Thank you. The member knows that I love a good government backbencher, and so challenging your own front benches is so important, of course. But what the member must understand is that the NHS will deliver better with a Labour government, and there is absolutely no doubt about that. If we get back to Scotland, we should say that patients using the private sector are creating a two-tier system, those who can afford to do that, and we have to acknowledge that. Those who can pay can get treatment, and those who can't are stuck in pain. And we do know that this government does book beds in the private sector. And I just say that to be honest about that, so that we can talk about it and how we move away from that. A&E waiting times remain stubbornly high, and we don't really have a clear plan from the SNP on how we can bring those down. These are long-term issues that have arisen and are becoming worse. And if the government truly want to work with us, they need to be honest about those. And so I am hopeful that they will be supporting the Labour Party amendment tonight so that we can work together. I'm conscious of time, so I'm going to move on. Looking forward to the future, which I absolutely believe the Cabinet Secretary wants to do, and I do believe he has honesty in wanting to work with us together on this, It is absolutely my view that one of the greatest challenges that we face is the divisive nature of health inequalities. And I know the Cabinet Secretary accepts that point. From cervical screening services uptake to deaths from alcohol and drugs, from childhood obesity to life expectancy, in 2024 in Scotland, your postcode still determines your health outcomes. And it's an absolute disgrace. For far too many, a high number of years in poor health, followed by early death, is a reality. This is a serious issue and one that tinkering around the edges will not resolve. Moving forward, we need to bring health services to our most deprived and vulnerable communities, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will work with us on that. We need to roll out screening at home in areas where uptake is low. We must invest in alcohol and drug partnerships, and it's excellent to have the Minister for that with us as well, because I know she too wants to make sure that we have those services on the ground so that we can challenge some of those things facing our communities. We have to invest in health outcomes for our children, extending access to free school meals to tackle hunger and improve opportunities to take up sport. And we need to do that by properly supporting our councils, by funding local government. It's absolutely essential that we fund local government. We need to work cross-portfolio to make sure that these things can happen. I think I'm supposed to be winding up. I'm getting that. I'm happy to talk about this again. I could talk about it all day. But the key thing is, if you want to work together, then we need to have some honesty. And I thank the presiding officer for that time.
Thank you. And I call on Ruth Maguire, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, presiding officer. I understand that conversations about the better performance of Scotland's NHS are not what those on a waiting list would want to hear. And I would never minimise the real pain and worry to patients and their families, or the pressure and stress to staff that issues in our healthcare system cause. But in the context of a parliamentary debate, it's perfectly reasonable to point out some facts about investment and action that the Scottish Government is making and taking. The SNP Scottish Government is choosing to invest more than £19.5 billion in health and social care, giving our NHS a real term to uplift in the face of UK government austerity, providing an uplift exceeding frontline Barnett consequentials, and meaning that resource funding for health and social care has more than doubled since 2006-07. And this includes £14.2 billion investment for our NHS boards, with additional investment of over £500 million. Presiding officer, that said, there is an urgent and critical need for health and social care reform. We have to change the way things are done. This morning in Health Committee, we heard the difference that research can make, so I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's announcement in that regard. Reform must focus on a healthcare system that is sustainable. Performance must improve. And we have to get prevention right. We've been talking about prevention for an awful long time. We have to shift resources and get that right, provide quality services and maximise access. The inequality that's still experienced in terms of access and outcomes for a large number of the communities that I represent is wholly unacceptable. And any reform must have a foundation of due consideration for the people at the very heart of that health and social care system. Patients, their families, and of course, the workforce. When I speak in these debates, I never lose sight of the very human aspect of debates about reform. The topic of health and social care is not an abstract one to me, and living in the area I represent, I have the same first-hand experience many of my constituents do, as do my friends and family, some of whom are employees too. In the context of ageing population, persistent health inequalities and fiscal pressures, delivering high-quality, person-centred service is indisputably challenging. I don't think there's anyone in here who would be so arrogant as to claim that they would be clear on exactly how to do that, to be clear that they had all the answers. In that regard, a national conversation is very welcome, and I thought Elena Whittam's eloquent remarks about her experience with her own community will provide rich learning for the government. One thing the SNP government is very clear about is that the answer to the challenges that we face is not privatisation. Now, my Labour Party colleagues are rightly proud of their party's role in forming the NHS, and they are also talking a lot about change at the moment. And notwithstanding Jackie Bailey's remarks, I would think that Ayrshire residents should be warned that there is the potential for Labour to shortchange them when it comes to protecting the NHS. They've been read before, but they're worth repeating. Labour's health spokesperson said last week that the party will go further than New Labour ever did, and that Labour want the NHS to form partnerships with the private sector that goes beyond just hospitals, having previously admitted that he will be, and I'm quoting directly, holding the door wide open to private interests in the NHS. Private healthcare investors have also stated that the Labour Party would kickstart private sector investment much more proactively than the Tories were able to do. Now, we will need consensus on exactly how to reform and improve things. My worry is that after 14 years of Tory austerity, the growing Westminster consensus between Tories and the Labour Party now seems far more interested in selling the NHS than in saving it. Yeah. The founding principle that the NHS in Scotland remains in the hands of the public and is free at the point of use will never change for the SNP. It's been clear today that the threat comes from Westminster, and that's why after the election, in the first 100 days, SNP MPs from Ayrshire, I hope, and across Scotland will bring forward a new law at Westminster to keep the NHS safely in public hands. A new SNP law that will bind the hands of any UK government, ensuring the health service is fully protected as publicly owned, publicly operated, and with its services publicly commissioned. The SNP will stand by the founding principles of the NHS, keeping it free at the point of delivery and keeping our health service where it belongs, in public hands, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Gillian Mackay. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. We should all continue to call for additional efforts and initiatives to support the recruitment and retention of clinicians and other NHS staff. As an example, the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh highlights that they would welcome a review of the NHS estate to ensure that medical staff have access to hot food during night shifts and adequate rest and changing facilities. We know that one of the biggest barriers to this is being able to leave a ward to access that in the first place, and we need to ensure that work on safe staffing is progressed at pace. As a front door to the health service, a thriving general practice not only brings direct benefits for its patients, but also serves to protect the entire NHS. Without general practice, the rest of the health service would be overwhelmed, and the NHS would simply not exist as we know it. There are obviously pressures in urgent care in many health boards as well. In the short term, we need to have enough staff and capacity to deal with what's coming through the door. In the medium and long term, we need to help GP services to ensure that they can see people to prevent them turning up at A&E unnecessarily. GP out of hours should also be supported and strengthened as a vital piece of the urgent care landscape. They're a hugely dedicated team who take on this role in addition to other responsibilities. The entire system is interconnected and interdependent, but that shouldn't provide excuses to not tackle the big issues or for us to have big conversations with service users, unions and stakeholders. As Sandesh Gulhanley rightly said, we do need to look at alternative routes into medical careers for both short and long-term workforce issues. We also, however, need the UK government to play their part. For example, international medical graduates who, if given indefinite leave to remain, could be part of the workforce for a long time to come. Eleanor Whittam's contribution prompted a thought that I don't think we've covered today. We've all set out national aspirations, but that in itself assumes that all of our health boards are facing the same challenges equally. We know that isn't the reality, so we need to tailor approaches to ensure they have the support they need. We need to see change in the short term to build clinician and patient confidence, because if they don't believe things are going to get better, it's going to be an uphill battle to continue reform. We need to see a realistic timetable from government on how and when things will change, and that we aren't going to see just another round of constant meetings and talking. We must continue to prioritise a preventative approach in order to alleviate the pressures on our NHS and enhance the general health of our population. And to continue a preventative approach means to build on strong progresses like minimum unit pricing and work on banning disposable vapes. In terms of workforce challenges, the increases in the number of medical school places across Scotland are an important step, but those increases must be matched by an urgent expansion of training posts for all who require them, across all specialities and in all parts of Scotland. Failure to expand training opportunities can only lead to extreme frustration in the medical workforce and will undermine attempts to retain doctors in the NHS. We must also listen to our junior doctors and new nurses to ensure that the training process is improved and we don't burn out new doctors and nurses. They will be our clinicians for generations to come. Their experiences need to be taken into account because some of them are not good, not getting their shifts when they should, missing major life events to ensure people get the right care, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. Like others, I want to briefly touch on mental health. Mental health problems are strongly linked to health and social inequalities. People living in the most deprived areas are also three times more likely to end up in hospital for mental health issues than those in the least deprived areas. We need better and more general practice in all areas of profound socio-economic deprivation to reduce the ill health and mortality our services can influence. We need to look at the treatment mix in mental health as well to ensure it reflects what the population actually needs. We will very soon have many young people who've only known talking therapies as part of their support through school transitioning to adult services. We don't have that same balance in adult services with a large provision of CBT. I think this is one example of something longer term that we need to look at now to ensure services are fit for when more young people come into adult services. There are a number of other conditions which, with investment, could have their outcomes radically improved. Funding closed-loop diabetes kits undoubtedly has positive benefits for users and has impacts on potential complications. Thrombectomy for those who have suffered a stroke can quite literally save lives, prevent disablement and prevent NHS spending. In large parts, at the moment, this is only a 9-to-5 service, literally creating a lottery depending on when you have a stroke. I wanted, in closing, Presiding Officer, to very briefly address the amendments. We will be abstaining on both. The Conservative amendment removes some good things that we got added to the motion, and while we support the majority of the Labour amendment, I believe that the number contained in it is so incorrect that we cannot support it. Presiding Officer, overall, I've been pretty disappointed by the debate as a whole this afternoon. To have a grown-up conversation, we actually all need to give up politically entrenched positions. There have been some good ideas, but a good idea wrapped in a party political broadcast isn't actually what people want, and we need to be so much better than this. I want to thank all of those who sent briefings in ahead of this debate and look forward to the ongoing conversations that are clearly needed and wanted on what the NHS needs to deal with its challenges we're currently facing and to ensure that it's fit for the future.
Thank you. I call on Paul Sweeney. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to be closing this debate for Labour because this party was the party that led the National Health Service Scotland Act through Parliament and brought the service into being on the 5th of July, coming up for 76 years ago next month. A huge milestone. And of course, the premise at the heart of the National Health Service, which certainly was not an immaculate conception. I don't know if anyone's managed to see the recent National Theatre production now. It showed the hugely fraught process that was involved with a number of stakeholders and interest groups in trying to bring the NHS into being. And we should not be complacent about the mythology. But certainly at the heart of it was the principle of it being free at the point of need. And it's certainly something that is a consensus across this chamber. And it's certainly something that Labour will always defend as a fundamental principle. However, in the course of this debate, I have found it rather ironic that a government motion before us references a commitment to the NHS free at the point of use, when actually this government has presided over the National Health Service in Scotland for almost a quarter of its existence and has in the process allowed a two-tier healthcare system to emerge in Scotland by a process of gradual disinvestment. So let's look, for example, at the period of 2007 to 2010, when the current First Minister was Finance Secretary. He failed to pass on Barnett consequentials from the Labour government at a UK level, and as a result, that trajectory has set in place a constraint on spending on the NHS in Scotland, which started with NHS expenditure per capita in Scotland at 17% higher when the government came into power in Scotland, the SNP, and it's today only 3% higher. So that gradual constraint on NHS expenditure has been a ratcheting effect which has caused major problems for our healthcare investment in Scotland. Yes, happy to give way.
John Mason.
I think I pressed the wrong button there. Apologies. Thank you to the member for giving way. He says that there should have been more money for the NHS. Would that mean he thinks there should have been less for local government?
Paul Sweeney.
Well, again, I don't want to get into the premises of national income accounting, but certainly this is not the sort of zero-sum game we're talking about. This is exactly the problem at the heart of the debate today, that simplistic analysis has led us to this position. We know that when we cut local government, it loads back onto the National Health Service. We know, for example, cutting programmes in our community leads to greater morbidity, greater ill health in the community. Then it loads into A&E departments. So it's a false accounting exercise. What we should be focusing on is cost avoidance. And here's an example. We know that people are suffering serious disablement, pain and invalidity out there in the community, because we can see it in the evidence that 40% of knee and hip operations carried out in Scotland have been paid for privately in the last year, and the number of self-paid hospital admissions are up almost 80% when compared to pre-pandemic levels. So whilst we have that shared idea that the health service in Scotland must be free, it's certainly not there at the point of need for many Scots. They are suffering in pain for a long time and having to spend their life savings, having to sell assets to fund their own well-being. And that is not sustainable, and it is not acceptable, and it defies the principles in which the National Health Service was established. And certainly we have heard some extreme examples today. I was quite struck by the member for Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley's talk about ambulances, because it's certainly something I've seen in my own casework, where a man came home from work to find his father on the floor having a stroke, waited on the ambulance, waited over 2 hours for the ambulance. By the time it came, got him to the hospital, the doctor had to come and break the news that it had been too long in waiting, therefore he had a permanent disability. Racked with guilt that had he got him into the car and got him to the hospital, his father might not have suffered that long-term disablement. That is what we're seeing daily in our health service in Scotland, and it defies the principle in which it was built. So I will say that we will not take lectures from the government on this matter about private medical care, which has driven our NHS into the ground. And the cynical misrepresentation of discussion about collaboration with innovators and researchers in the private sector or in the universities is completely unacceptable, because it actually defies the history of the National Health Service. Let's look at one example. In fact, one of the most greatest achievements actually in the NHS was a public-private collaboration. In the 1970s, the record label EMI, which was pioneering the Beatles at that time, earned lots of money through the revenue generated by the Beatles record sales, ploughed it into research EMI Central Laboratories to develop what became the CT scanner. But it was partnering with the Department for Health and Social Security at the time, which invested £600,000 in development of what became the CT scanner. Geoffrey Hounsfield, who worked in collaboration with the NHS as the chief scientist at EMI, won the Nobel Prize. The CT scanner built as a legacy of the NHS, a private-public partnership. That is what we're talking about when it's about bringing in the innovations we need to improve our healthcare system. And it was talked about here. Miss Webber, the member for Lothians, talked about productivity issues in our NHS. This is exactly the sort of thing we can improve with this sort of collaboration and investment. You know, operating theatres not operating to optimal efficiency. We know that there's medical technology companies in Scotland today who have products which can improve the productivity of the NHS, but they're not even getting a look in at bringing those technologies to bear in the NHS, which cannot be developed in-house because they're pioneering cutting-edge discrete specialist technologies. Companies across Glasgow and elsewhere in Scotland are offering these opportunities to the NHS, but they're not being brought in to bear. This is what we should be doing to improve our healthcare system in Scotland. We know for 17 years the NHS certainly budget has been under pressure, but certainly also what's been under pressure, as was mentioned, is the budgets of local councils up and down the country that's left health and social care partnerships strapped for cash, unable to fulfil the care needs of the community. And those working in the care sector are not paid nearly enough to sustain them, and they are leaving the profession and leaving vacancies which continue to backload pressure on the healthcare system. That is why we need that new deal for working people that will transform the terms and conditions for care workers, including a clear path to £15 an hour for care workers, because we recognise the importance of carers and our healthcare staff across the professions. They deserve better. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Tess White. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The NHS is an incredible national asset.
but as we have repeatedly heard today, it's on its knees. For 17 years, the SNP government has been the custodian of Scotland's healthcare service, but it is out of ideas and out of time. Perhaps that explains SNP Westminster leader Stephen Flynn's ludicrous intervention yesterday that abdicated any responsibility for the state of Scotland's fully devolved health service. It was shameful. It was grievance-mongering. But sadly, it's something we've come to expect from the SNP. And Professor James Mitchell was spot on when he said this latest deflection from the SNP was evasive and simplistic, with no serious engagement with the challenges that the NHS faces. In a new report this week, the Royal College of Nursing has laid bare some of these challenges. It's found that more than a third of nurses have delivered care in settings such as hospital corridors, with alarming implications for patient safety. The situation is so bad that the RCN have described it as a national emergency, a national emergency, presiding officer. Dr. Sandesh Gulhani said the SNP has chosen to manipulate Scottish parliamentary time to serve their own UK general election electioneering purposes. This is an affront to every Scot who relies on the NHS and to every healthcare professional who dedicates their life to serving others. But wherever you look, presiding officer, whether it's primary or secondary care, the situation is critical for Scotland's NHS. Delayed discharge is up by 12% on last year. There have been almost 500,000 fewer operations compared to the pre-pandemic period. Consultant vacancies are up by more than 11% in a year. Nursing vacancies remain stubbornly high. The number of GP surgeries across every health board is down on a decade ago. Ambulances are stuck outside A&Es, especially Aberdeen Royal Infirmary in my region, and they're stuck for hours at a time. NHS services are increasingly being centralised to urban areas. Minor injury units in rural communities are closing or restricting their hours, and some rural health boards can't even recruit GPs. And what about the 1 in 7 Scots languishing on NHS waiting lists for months and even years as their condition deteriorates? What about the national treatment centres, including those in NHS Grampian and Tayside in my region, that were promised to relieve the pressures on the system but have been put on ice? Worst of all, presiding officer, we know that people are dying unnecessarily. For A&E alone, there were as many as 2,000 excess deaths in 2023. For too long, the SNP have presided over a process of managed decline in the NHS. Successive SNP health ministers have overpromised and underperformed. NHS staff and patients are paying the price, with intolerable workforce pressures, inadequate infrastructure and unbearably long waits for people in pain and discomfort. They don't want to hear it, presiding officer, but it is those on the SNP benches who are responsible for the NHS in Scotland. And it is those on the SNP benches who are making spending decisions and determining spending priorities. This crisis will only get worse with an ageing population and growing demand on a healthcare system that simply does not have the capacity to respond. A national conversation on the future of the NHS is welcome, but ultimately we need solutions. Today the Cabinet Secretary talked about transformation of services and having a national conversation. He used the word reform at least 7 times. In fact, I stopped counting. It was so used so often, presiding officer. Why have the previous health secretaries and this current cabinet secretary not been listening to key stakeholders such as the RCN, the Royal College of Midwives, the Royal College of Surgeons? Presiding officer, the SNP government has the feedback it needs. It is action that is lacking. Today, Humza Yousaf was here at the start of the debate, but I noticed it didn't take long for Humza Yousaf to scarper out of the chamber when he heard the current... Did you hear that? Presiding Officer, when he scarpered out of the chamber when he heard the current Health Cabinet Secretary talk about reform being required. Today, Carol Mocken talked about honesty and the importance of honesty when you're having a conversation. But, Presiding Officer, how can one have an honest conversation with this SNP government when it deflects and it denies? Deflection, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary questioned the figure from Public Health Scotland of 840,000 people on NHS waiting lists out last Tuesday. I am going to refer, Presiding Officer, to the backbench SNP, Christine Graham, has been referred to today, but I will in a minute, Ms Graham. And denial when each SNP backbencher, and I'm coming to you, Christine Graham, when each SNP backbencher today electioneered with anti-Westminster rhetoric, even if it is from one of our favourite SNP backbenchers banging on her grievance drum. And sorry, I won't take an intervention. I think I've had enough of banging on the drum, Presiding Officer. So this should be, Presiding Officer, about fixing and future-proofing.
Let's hear the member.
Scottish Conservatives have already... I think the SNP don't want to hear what I've got to say, Presiding Officer, but I would like to finish. The Scottish Conservatives
let us hear Ms. White.
Have already delivered in this regard. We were the first of Scotland's parties to contribute detailed and credible proposals to this conversation. And as Dr. Gulhani said, for all of our population, urban, rural and island, we would take a modern, efficient and local approach to healthcare reform, which increases capacity and addresses demand. We would introduce a 24/7 digital health service through a My NHS Scotland app. And the Cabinet Secretary says primary care is the bedrock of our NHS, but there is no evidence that the primary healthcare Cabinet Secretary is on its knees. We would deliver 1,000 additional GPs, an investment of 12% of the NHS budget into GP clinics, and a new national standard guaranteeing patients an appointment within the week. We would establish maximum waiting times across all major NHS metrics. Presiding Officer, in closing, our NHS has reached crisis point.
Ms White, I'm just going to take Christine Graham for a point of order.
I seek your guidance, Presiding Officer. Two members have been mentioned, Mr Youssef and myself, in rather disparaging manner by the Speaker. Is it not incumbent upon the Speaker, therefore the member, therefore to let us intervene and respond back?
It is a matter, Ms Graham, for the member who is speaking as to whether or not they accept any intervention. Ms White,
thank you, Presiding Officer. In fact, that was a point made. It is not a point of order, as we heard, we hear constantly. If Neil Gray, Presiding Officer, in closing, is serious about reform, the SNP government must step up, stop shirking responsibility, and finally show some leadership. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Neil Gray to wind up. Up to 9 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank the Chamber today for this important discussion on the future of health and social care services. I say that at the outset to be constructive and collaborative and seek consensus. There are some exceptions which I will come to. But I opened the debate with a genuine call for openness and collaboration. I intend to continue the same approach as we take our reform agenda forward. And I want to genuinely thank those who contributed today. I'll touch on some of them in detail and thank others if I get time at the end of the contribution. First of all, Sandesh Gulhani, I want to temper his cynicism around the timing of this debate, as it has been well trailed for quite some time since I came into post, and indeed was proposed long before the election was called. While I also agree with him regarding putting more money into primary care and agree that in the long run this will realise health and financial improvements, we'll not see those savings in the short term. So I am keen for the reform discussion genuinely to apply our cranial attention attention to how we do that without affecting the current secondary care services. He was also wrong in his assertion about this government's funding of health and social care. The Treasury's own figures, and this is also to contradict both Carol Mochan and Paul Sweeney about their assertions around funding for the health service by this government. The Treasury's own figures show that if health spending in Scotland had matched England per head, it would have seen £15 billion less for the NHS in Scotland between 2006-07 and 2022-23. Jackie Bailey set out the challenges, as many people across the chamber did, but didn't rise to the challenge of today about where we go from here. But I will turn to her remarks in more detail shortly, and in the theme of Carol Mochan's asking for honesty. Gillian Mackay made two very good contributions, very helpful contributions, which rightly turned on the need to target prevention and investing in primary care. And Alex Cole-Hamilton's assessment of the challenge that there is within our health service is real, but again failed to live up to the anticipation that I'd set for the Chamber in terms of how we move forward. Sadly, like others, he failed in that regard. In terms of mental health funding, of course, mental health funding is up under this government, and the CAMHS figures today, contrary to Alex Cole-Hamilton's perspective, shows progress and the best performance for many years after the doubling of the budget and of staff. I'll turn to other contributions, including those from Jacqueline Barr, Christine Graham, Elena Whittam, Ruth Maguire, in more detail, which were very helpful. Carol Mochan and Sue Webber I'll also turn to, I hope, in my contribution. Presiding Officer, I've today outlined this government's vision for reform, the actions we are already taking to improve and reform our health and social care services. Our intention to reform health and social care is now well established. The vision that will drive this reform to enable people to live longer, healthier, more fulfilling lives, underpinned by the four key areas of prevention, quality service provision, increased access, and with people at its heart, is broad and deep. It spans population health interventions that will improve our general health through a person-centred approach to clinical and service operating models that will drive improvements across our health and social care services. I will try to come to interventions shortly once I've made some progress. Now is the time to drive forward the reform activity that will ensure that we deliver the vision. It has never been more urgent and requires concentrated action across government to maximise efforts across portfolios and across society. This will include education, housing, communities, transport, and be impacted by income and economic opportunity as well as physical and mental health. It is clear that we need to work not only across government but across health boards, community planning, education, business and other health services. So our vision is focused on change and improvement within current NHS structures, maximising current assets and delivering a population-based approach to the planning of acute services that will transcend traditional boundaries. This task will crucially need to harness the potential of research-proven technologies and scientific innovations, whilst also maintaining focus on the outcomes that really matter to people. Their rapid national adoption will be critical to ensure that health services in Scotland have sustainability, address health inequalities and deliver improved patient outcomes. Crucially, all of us need to reset the relationship with our health and that of our nation. Taking a collective responsibility for a healthier Scotland is the only truly sustainable way that we can protect and improve our health services. I must reiterate, I am not looking to publish a new strategy. My focus is now firmly on delivery, building on the foundations already developed over the past decade or so, including the 2010 Quality Strategy, the 2016 National Clinical Strategy and the 2016 Realistic Medicine Strategy, among others. To do this, we will work to implement an NHS Scotland approach to harness greater levels of collaboration in our health boards and partners, resulting in better value, better quality, better outcomes for patients and staff. Through all of this change, we must not lose sight. I'll try to shortly. I need to get through these remarks first. We will not lose sight of the fundamental mission of healthcare, which is addressing the needs of each and every person who has the need to receive care from our health and social care services. Now, I did not want this afternoon to move into this space, as I've said to opposition spokespeople when I outlined why I wish this to be a debate rather than a statement. I wanted a discussion to be had, not on where we are, because we have ample opportunity to discuss that, and we accept that there is a need for reform and improvement, as I set out in our motion. I wanted this to be about how we move forward, but Jackie Bailey, Paul Sweeney and others have really tested my resolve there, as it is important that if we are to quote figures, we do so accurately. The figures quoted in Labour's amendment today are wrong. They are misleading, and we can leave it for other people to judge for themselves as to why Labour would wish to provide misleading and inflated figures regarding waiting times in Scotland when they have record waiting times in Wales at present. There are not 840,000 people on NHS waiting lists. That is misleading, as many people will be waiting for more than one procedure or test. The Public Health Scotland report says very clearly that figures for new outpatient appointments should not be added to patient inpatient figures. Presiding officer, when that warning is on the same report that Labour have surely taken those figures from, they will have had to read past that to get to the figures today. I wonder if that would constitute Labour knowingly misleading not just this Parliament but also the people of Scotland as to the figures that are before us. They can't quote those figures without reading that warning first. I, of course, accept that still leaves too many people waiting. It still leaves too many outstanding appointments. But on issues like this, when we need to take people with us on the journey and process of reform, with difficult decisions to be made, we have to make sure we are accurate rather than scaremongering. And when that fact is coupled with what we currently have as Labour's plan for the health service, which amounts to £134 million extra in Scotland, that would barely cover a 1% pay rise for NHS staff. Try explaining that one to staff. It is also less than the Tory consequentials received in year following the most recent budget. So that is not a plan for change from Labour. That is a continued short change of Scotland and its health services from, in this case, a Labour UK government rather than a Tory UK government. That is why we cannot support either amendment today and why it is so important that the thrust of today's debate is so important, which is about having a serious dialogue about reform, about improvement, accepting, yes, of course, too many people are waiting for too long, but setting out a plan to address the immediate challenge, coupled with improving our population health, investing in prevention and embracing the opportunity that arises from technology and innovation. That's what I genuinely hoped that, and hope that the national conversation engagement, which includes colleagues across this Parliament, will deliver. And I look forward to embarking that on a shared spirit of endeavour. Presiding officer, I said in my opening remarks that I want to approach this task with a spirit of cooperation. This vital period of reform and improvement has to proceed on a truly national basis. After all, the founder of the NHS, quoted already today, Aneurin Bevan, famously said that the NHS will endure as long as there are folk left with a faith to fight for it. I do believe that there is a broad consensus in this chamber with a deep and abiding faith in our health and social care services, and I also believe, collectively, we have the ability to fight and reform and improve them for the challenges of today and tomorrow and the future. And I thank colleagues for their contribution. I look forward to working together to progress this vital task ahead of us. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on a vision for health and social care in Scotland. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 13492 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 13492 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And there are five questions to be put as a result of today's business, and I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. And I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. And the first question is that motion 13464, in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville, on Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill at Stage 1, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 13176, in the name of Shona Robison, on a financial resolution for the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the next question is that amendment 13466.2, in the name of Sandesh Gulhani, which seeks to amend motion 13466, in the name of Neil Gray, on a vision for health and social care in Scotland, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.